Marcus.
You have a number.
Over here. So you were. So you were. And you're on the camera, right?
Yeah.
You can move the camera up if you want to get some more close-ups.
Incorporate that open.
How are you making that?
¿Qué pasó?
Let's change the way they do it. Real big fast.
Is this a stop in New York? Like, you go to quit, you find somebody in session or somebody, and then you kind of like, including it with the whole big trip? May not be the thing to do, like, what you and I might need to do is do like an immediate plan, or you need to be coming back over here in 6 months just to go to the seminars. Not 6 months, like 6 weeks, you know what I'm saying? Like, maybe like the first weekend of September, we can fly right to New York. And of course, you can see Thais right there and all that. And it's an extra time to plan. We go there with planning, like, to go to school, that's kind of better energy, better luck, you know? That's what I'm thinking about, you know what I mean?
Cool.
And if we can work it out, like, for you to go up over here. New York, fly out, one Thursday, like, if you're playing these days out, you could always take a plane.
If I'm trying to visit, it's a, yeah, do the principle.
Like, and maybe if your plane's leaving, like,
why are you on more 7, 8 o'clock?
Which people probably be in Richmond by like 3 p.m. I take my first train out, you know? And it's only like $70. And so, and I mean, whatever the situation is, I mean, like, we talk about it.
Hey, y'all, get away from that table over there. She saw over here, thank you.
Hello?
Here we go. But you understand what I'm saying?
I mean, because Rob's got you just coming with some guys from, right? That's good, yeah. Yeah, it was.
I
All right, go back to having fun. I would, if you call the bar, whatever, you're rolling, you know what I mean? But the one I'm looking forward to having you work at.
With you, man.
And I'm sure everybody's looking forward to seeing you. Everyone's looking forward to seeing you here, too.
All that ass, brother.
Wait, no uncles working out with each other. Why is that happening? What is going on here? Tim?
You almost went there.
You can work out over here. I'm sorry, we need to be. Hold on, wait. What do you want, whatever you want?
Doing all the hands.
Anybody here doing toy mop?
Toy mop.
You doing toy mop?
Toy mop?
Toy mop? All right, work with his left now, move him up to the, your side outside.
He's catching hands.
Fine, this kid uses the one step, jibs out down.
Cheater!
Thanks.
Try to fix a little my shit.
But everybody goes.
I first section of Steel and Tap. Alright, you're with your partner, practice pox out. No pox dar, pox out only. First section, ceiling tap. Pox out only. No pox dar. Practicing pox out. Go ahead. With your partner, practice your pox out exercise.
right, switch.
Not switch, I mean, stay with the same person you're with. Now, play the pox out real soft and gentle. You make no noise at all. You hear no slap. Or it's a gentle slap. Who says a slap has to be loud? What is the sound of one hand slapping? There you go.
Is that for the pox or for the punch? Or both?
If a tree falls in the forest and no one witnesses it, does it make a noise?
Yes.
Physics.
So what is the sound of one hand clapping? It is a pox sound. All right, all tomfoolery of profound Zen idioms aside, pox out. Study the nature of what it means to slap or deflect. Okay? When you punch, you should be sticking a bit to the person who's blocked. When you feel yourself get blocked, you should totally relax and surrender to that block. You can't fight against the block. The only thing you can do is change your hands later. You cannot fight against a block. You can only change your hand to another position and counter what has occurred. But you don't want to resist a block. You don't want to force your way into a block. You simply want to know what's going on. You have contact with the person, so therefore, you have an option as to what to do next. Your last option should be force against the block. There has to be something else you can do. Some other movement. You just feel the block. Those who are blocking, you must occupy center. Your job is to block. You have to accomplish that job. Occupy the center line. Control it. All right, now everyone stand at a greater distance from each other. Same exercise, full arm out. You can pox out the wrist or the fist on this exercise. Full arm out. If you think you're standing far enough from each other, stand back even further. Same gentle, soft rule applies. Let's go. No cupping, fingertips straight together. This is a Wu Sao hand position, outer gate Wu Sao hand position. This is not the floppy disc position. It is in here with everything, guys. Yo, ZH. Come on. All right, now speed it up a little bit. Now, the person who is playing the pox out, really occupy the center. You will notice a greater degree of energy use to get that center line. Make sure when you're occupying center, it is your wrist occupying center, not your hand. Pop far enough so that the wrist is controlling the center. The wrist covers the hand. Don't pop upward, cover a little bit. Okay, take a break. Take a break, relax yourself, sit down. Everybody take a break, relax, sit down somewhere. Try not to sit down. Lead.
That, this is really funny, the second section, you know, it's like, yeah, stagger yourself so you can do the full part this way. Second section's really kind of funny, like, there is a way where you can play this with, like, a lot of energy if you wanted to, but do not a lot. Especially, like, in class. Like, there's a way to cover up your kung fu you guys gotta start. Y'all remember the seminar where I was teaching people, notice how conveniently I turned my back to the camera to show this technique, okay? You know, I came out, showed you the punch, and I showed you how to apply this technique before going into this. You gotta really even cover that up. You know, like, when you play this, you're like, boom. And just, no one knows, but your conscience is there. You know you can do this. You know, if you need to. For what reason? You'll find out in your kung fu life thing. Or maybe it'll never be a technique you ever have to use. I've had to use it. I know that it's worthwhile. Therefore, I teach it, you learn it, I learn it, I develop it, but I cover it up too. Anyone from within the family, if they didn't know about the technique, they wouldn't see me do it, because they see this. And someone outside of them doesn't even have an idea what the hun sao is anyway. A peach. So, middle section with a lot of energy. Interesting how Wing Chun trains that. Because the nature of it, the first section has that degree of softness in the praying Christ the Buddha section. Very soft. In the praying Christ the Buddha section is the part that has three wu sao's in. Three wu sao's, we call them three wu sao sections with three protecting hands. That's a more modern Western way of understanding that, instead of understanding the Eastern philosophy of that. Okay? The way the Chinese call that section is praying thrice the Buddha section. Not that we study Buddhism here, but their prayer hands come in like this. And they bounce like. That means a high respect when you move your prayer hands out and then in. Out and then in. Instead of like this. You know, what is this? When you see something, you're like, oh, you're bringing your hands into you? That's total respect. You know, here, right, I can go like this, you know, but technically my hands are in a launch position. Here, yeah, no, I can bring them back and launch them out, but at least I'm demonstrating my hands are staying into me, you know. Just like this section, this is into me. My kung fu is very personal to me. I will bow and take my eyes off the authority, you know. Wing Chun sensitivity should be at such a degree that you feel everything anyway. What does it mean to you have your eye on your opponent, you know? That's another thing at a time. Second line sensitivity, though, is very important. Anyway, this middle section, the second section of Sino Town, really deserves 3 good years of very soft, gentle, and methodical attention. Very relaxed, soft, gentle, very, very, very gentle, very relaxed. And let it just drop almost. Learn how to drop before putting energy behind something that's dropping. Something that's dropping is fine. Then when you learn how to put a rocket boost behind that thing that's dropping, you got gravity helping plus everything else. Bottom line is, it's easy to drop this one. But can you get the same feeling of dropping out of this one? Is the question. When you punch someone, do you need to put effort out the blood just to sink in a blow? Sinking in or dropping a blow into you? Am I like forcing out a thrusting thing? Or am I like holding a hammer in? Hitting you with it almost, you know? What are you doing? Same with the palm. Can you drop a palm out? Drop. Drop, same thing, you know? Drop, what's this? You know? Can I make that same dropping feeling? Can gravity help me out here too? You know, so that's the whole thing. Second section, give it some relaxed, soft attention, okay? Even the senior brothers, they will remember Batman. They just had one of them Kwai Chang Kane Kung Fu flashbacks. They're like, damn, that's right. You know, you kept us doing that shit soft about 5 years. That bastard boy was tough to understand. Shit, I hated this guy. Oops, am I talking out loud again? You know. Can't hear him. Anyway. So, I mean, they remember. If you ask Marcus and Andre, easy. They know how the first 5 or 6 years work. I never let that early generation hardly use any energy. Then a lot of people around town thought I was ripping them off. But now I've seen students that have enough energy, feel like they could crack a hole in the side of a mountain. You know, big old giant slab. Bam! With a palm strike, you feel like a crack on it. For sure, they crack somebody's sternum with a palm strike or a fist. They didn't get that power from practicing fast all the time. Now, I'm not saying my grandstudents are practicing fast. You guys understand about the soft nature. But if I'm taking time to say this over and over and over, then I'm telling you to soften up 10 times more than you already know. You know, the It's just like having to tell you a story about Chicago. Hey, you have a lot of good foundation here. Later on, when you remember this story, maybe you got to repeat it to your students, or you got to think about it again and figure out what I really meant by that story, you understand some things there. But let me tell you, if I take a little time, if I take over 3 seconds to talk about something, or 3 minutes to talk about something, and it relates to Wing Chun training, I'm not just harping on something that could be a nag. I am saying it for a very good reason. I said, 3 years, from anybody in here right now, even the most senior students, could get a 3-year cycle, or 3 years worth of training a day. I've done it. 21 years studying under Moriah, I have started my Kung Fu over at least a half dozen times. And even when I started my Kung Fu over, I have looked at the second section of Ceiling Tower, which is connected to other parts of the whole system, but I've sometimes just studied that, and only that, for a long time. And played Pak Chow with some people, like, real slow motion and soft, just for months at a time, commit to doing that and do it. You get a result that never goes away. Every time you increase your Kung Fu power, like you put another cinder block of power on it, or, you know, like laying, you know, like a brick onto a building, it doesn't go away. See, like when people don't complete their Kung Fu training, they kind of have a half-completed building. They might have the frame all done and roughed in plumbing and stuff, then even start some walls, but then they stop, that's it. Maybe it'll grow a little bit slower before it's completed, but the nature of a Kung Fu guy, what you're doing is, every time you play a ceiling tower, it's like you put another brick on a good building, that's your building.
Okay, but that's your building, yeah.
And then you play a ceiling tower 10,000 times, it's 10,000 bricks, you fix part of the house there. Another couple of years, another 10,000 times, more bricks. Finally, when it's done, the house is still there, right? Only thing that's gonna move it away is the act of God, you know, when you die. So that's it. The point is that Kung Fu's like that. Kung Fu's not a pump you get, and then when you don't work out, you lose it. You always keep the Kung Fu. It's like riding a bicycle. There's something about riding a bicycle that is very much Kung Fu, if you think about it. And there's a reason why people don't lose the ability to ride a bicycle once they gain it. You don't all of a sudden start teeter-tottering again, or need training wheels again. You know, you might get on a wobble a little tiny bit, but for the most part, once you get that balance, that's it. Once you understand that particular dynamic, and you can do it, your body adjusts that, that's it. You understand? So Kung Fu is, of course, much deeper, more intricate than that, but something about that nature is still the same. Every time you play the Ceiling Tower, it's like putting another layer of Kung Fu from the inside out, but at the same time, from the outside in. Like, in other words, the layers built out here, also, then it meets in the middle. Then you're nice and thick with Kung Fu. That's the way my people used to like to say about it. So if you get that kind of picture, you sort of feel it. I mean, maybe it doesn't physically occur like that. Then again, maybe it does. You know? Obviously, we don't physically occur like a house being built. But then again, maybe we do. You know? As we progress day by day through time, you know, there's something about us that does develop. There's something that evolves. So in an abstract way, maybe we do, all right? So you got to think of your Kung Fu training like that. Take time and study the detail. This middle section has a lot of detail to it. You really should take time and look at it more, and it's softer. You know, just let it drop. Get a good stretch. The nature of Ceiling Tower is stretch. These just drop. Like you see this is part of the detail. But people can't see that. You can't show them. It has to be one fluid motion. And then it comes back in. This part of the detail. People shouldn't see that though. It should be one fluid motion. They may see the double tonsal, but by the time they see the fuk sao, there's a jut. And then view. Then this sinking motion here, sometimes you don't even see this move. Depends on the nature of the person playing. This, obviously, they're going to see something rising. But that whole energy, there's a lot there in Ceiling Tower. And believe me, you got to look for the other connections to the system from this middle part too. As you play more comfortably, you look at the forms, you look at the way you're playing chi sao stuff. Where's the connection between the forms and chi sao? You know? All right. So first and second section, one more time here. Ready? All the senior brothers understand this at a serious level, at their level. The youngest brother in here understands this at their level. We're doing the first and second section of Ceiling Tower. Now we're getting ready to play Pak Sao with Pak Dar. The senior brothers understand this at their level. And everyone else, whatever year you're at, you understand this at your level. and everyone is working, getting something out of this exercise. So I'm telling you, even look deeper. This is all at your level. Senior brothers love going over this stuff again and again, like the rings around a tree. You're gonna see the same thing again, but that tree is gonna be thicker every year, all right? First and second section, little idea form. So soft, you don't even feel the snap. Almost like a push. You don't feel the snap at the end. You don't feel your elbow lock. Your body does not jar at all. Very gentle. Don't feel a lock. Bones are not locking. Energy is not snapping. Just drops, but no elbow lock. Oops, sad elbow lock. No elbow lock. No elbow lock. It's hard to judge that. All right, I'm pumping, sorry. No elbow lock. Smooth. Soft. No jarring of the body. Okay, now real soft and slowy. Not as slow as that first section, three protecting hands part. Not as slow as that. But give it that slow, soft Tai Chi feeling. Actually, Tai Chi comes from Wing Chun. Think about the timing of that section. The timing. 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 Slow rising. Descends with gravity, but certainly should be slower rising. If you want speed and power, practice the move slow and soft for about 10 days, and then do that same move with power, and you'll see what I mean. Then discipline yourself to practice that same move for 1 year. So go ahead, do 10 days. Practice your punches in the air in slow motion in general. And at the end of 10 days, snap them out. You'll feel all this incredible new level of energy. Imagine if you do something like that on an ongoing training cycle. So you gotta be in a think like that. I'm giving you this word of caution because you guys are advancing. And one thing about Kung Fu guys, they advance. If they start forgetting the basics,
they're dead. Not good.
So any Sifu or Sigong or Sitagong's job is always to repeat this. Oh. Any questions? Okay, now. Find yourself a partner and practice Pak Sao, Pak Dar for the sake. There's enough people in here even for partners, right? Is it, who does not have a partner?
Okay, so you're good with that. I mean, you warming up now? Still in there in the forms?
Cool.
Keep doing that. I'll check in with Chief Sergeant here in a minute. See, you don't need to do pasta a lot sometimes, so here it is. You're a master already. Is it on then? So it's only on when the red light's on, is that it?
Yeah.
Beat 1-2. 1-2. 1-2. 1-2. 1-2. 1-2. Do that section again, like when you hit the center line again, person. Do the section where you hit the center line again. Okay.
Here. You're coming up and doing this, right? Then. Okay. Again. One more time. All right. Then you come make it this first. And make this one, and then shift into it. Then open, like this, first one. And practice here, and hold your fist back here. Then put this up, don't bring them down together, okay? And then make a fist here, and then you go low. Section like five times at least. Just that middle section. At least a good five times. Study the detail. Like the timing. Like when you step, you know, this bong style is completed by the time you finish stepping. So when to start, like putting that bong style in your motion so there's a double thing going on there. And feel it. Get in the motion. Really sit to that side so that when you hit, you really got to move your horse to hit to the side too. So it's really, it's that funky little section, you know. That timing is very important.
could go lower to you. Not as low as this. This is really low, but this right here can like red low.
I'm not going to tell you anything about the third section. I'm going to give you some time to think. These step at the same time, and then the body, you really have to have the hand. These have to be pointing down. So they have to be from here. See, they're here, and then the hands don't move. The body comes up to where the hands are, so therefore it's pointing down. You don't pull the hands back and point down. You're here. As you step forward, the body steps forward. The hands stay in the same position, pointing down, so they should be about here. So like if I stay here, right? Okay. And you move forward. See, that's how the hands go big. All right, so you're here, you move forward, go. All right, right there. But it shouldn't go down, it should stay here. These are gonna look like they're a little out of your borderline for a minute, no big deal for now. So your tops out here, now go. Right, that's where they should be, just pretty much. Do it again. Yeah, they should be like right about there, not touching that a little bit, and this foot in, knee in, a lot. Turn that out a little. Turn them out together, see? And he has to be really bent, and the weight has to be all on the back leg, and the hips have to turn forward. You're twisting like a pretzel, that's what you have to do. It's a very strenuous exercise, a pain in the butt, but you gotta twist up like a pretzel. Because when you get in fights, a lot of times your body is twisted up. We have so much training being twisted up, it doesn't bother us. You gotta practice being twisted up a lot. So twist a lot when you practice twisting and bending. Okay?
Twisting.
It's like a dance class. Twist and bend and twist. No changing hands. Lops out. Lops out. No changing hands. Concentrate on that one side. What do you see? What do you feel? What is the connection? Okay. Everybody take a break. Face the front. Ceiling tap.
All right. Sit around the table. We're done.